Gurunji Senior Secondary School, CBSE, Namakkal.
Successful, result-producing school in state every year.
Administered by the Board of Directors with over 35 years of experience in the teaching field.
Special attention on art, craft, music, dance, silambam, yoga, skating and karate.
Focus on Hindi Sabha and Spell Bee Olympiad exams.
Smart class for effective and innovative learning and well-furnished library.
Solitary importance on sports and games in state and national level.
WhatsApp facilities to know activities of students and school inside the campus.
NEET, JEE, IIT coaching experts from Rajasthan and Andhra Pradesh along with our effective teachers.
Admission registration for classes LKG to plus 2.
Kurunji Educational Institution, Kavetipatti, Namakkal. Admission in progress. CBSE, KG to 12, contact 9025895176. Metric 6 to 12, contact 9344567484. For online admission, log on to www.kurunjischoolnkl.in.
See here, ma. So it is third class from atoms and nuclear chapter. In our previous class, we focused on Bohr model. I told you two important points from Bohr model, and in previous class we started Bohr model, but we discussed Rutherford's model and drawback of Rutherford's model, impact parameter, right? So these are all we discussed. From starting of this chapter, you know, we discussed what is alpha particle and what is alpha particle scattering experiment. What is the relation between number of scattered particles and angle of scattering theta? After that, we also discussed the distance of closest approach. Okay? Especially in the last class, we discussed impact parameter and Rutherford's model, then drawbacks of Rutherford's model. Afterwards, we started to discuss Bohr model. So it's not completed. Discussion about Bohr model, only 2 points completed. Remaining points we are going to discuss in this class. Okay, right. But what are the 2 points we discussed? Once again, I'll repeat you. You please be concentrate. The first point, what I already discussed to you is the whole, right? The first point, what I already discussed to you is, see here, the atom consists of a central nucleus containing the entire positive charge and almost all the mass of the atom. I'll repeat once again. The atom consists of central nucleus containing the entire positive charge and almost all the mass of the atom. The electron revolve around the nucleus in certain discrete circular orbits. The necessary centripetal force for circular orbits is provided by the Coulomb attraction between the electron and the nucleus. Between the electron and the nucleus. Okay. This is what he is talking about. This is what the first point from Bohr model. This is what Bohr has spoken. So what is the first point, ma? The atom consists of central nucleus containing the entire positive charge and almost all the mass of the atom, right? The electron revolve around the nucleus in certain discrete circular orbits. So whatever the necessary centripetal force for circular orbits provided by the Coulomb attraction between the electron and the nucleus. Okay. Second point, which is not here, which completed in the last class, but I am repeating once again. The allowed orbits for the electrons are those in which the electron does not radiate energy. These orbits are also called stationary orbits. These orbits are also called stationary orbits. Okay, right. See here, the allowed orbits for the electrons are those in which the electron does not radiate energy. These orbits are also called stationary orbits. Stationary orbits, okay? So when the electron is revolving in stationary orbit, it doesn't emit energy and it doesn't absorb energy. Okay? Right. Next point which is written here, ma, you just observe carefully. First point, the stationary orbits are those in which angular momentum of electron is h by 2 pi. That is, we are writing mathematical form, mvr is equal to n into h by 2 pi. N is nothing but here integer, right? N is being integer or the principal quantum number. Okay, right. So I'll repeat once again the first point, which is most important point, which is talking about the angular momentum of the electron. Okay, see here, the stationary orbits are those in which angular momentum of the electron is h by 2 pi. That is, mvr is equal to n into h by 2 pi. N is the integer or the principal quantum number. Okay, right. Next point. The radiation of energy occurs only when an electron jumps from one permitted orbit to another. I'll repeat once again. The radiation of energy occurs only when an electron jumps from one permitted orbit to another. Okay. Next point. What is the meaning of the fourth point, ma, from Bohr model? You know, radiation of energy occurs when electron jumps from one permitted orbit to another. There are different orbits, no? Right. When the electron is jumping from one orbit to another orbit, what happens? If it is going to jump from lower energy orbit to the higher energy orbit, it needs energy. When it is jumping from higher energy orbit to the lower energy orbit, it will release energy in the form of radiation, right? That is, the situation takes place between any two orbits regarding the jumping of electron in an atom. Next point, see here. When electron jumps from higher energy orbit to the lower energy orbit, for example E2 to E1, then the difference of energies of these orbits, E2 minus E1, emits in the form of photon. But if electron goes from E1 to A2, E1 to E2, it absorbs the same amount of energy, and this energy is equal to difference of energies of these orbits, right? So please keep in mind what happens when electron jump from one orbit to another orbit. Okay, right. See here, this is what here he is talking about angular momentum of the electron, and this is what radiation of energy occurs when the electron jumps from one permitted orbit to another, right? For this fourth point only, fifth point is complete explanation. Okay, right. Next, drawbacks of Bohr's atom model, right? Okay, see here. Next, see the first point in the drawbacks. It is valid only for one electron atoms. See here. So these are the drawbacks of Bohr's atom model, ma. So for atomic model we have many. Thomson, Sommerfeld, Rutherford, Bohr. Even I am giving the little number, but there is a big list, right? In chemistry you are getting complete chapter, that is what atomic structure. So what I am saying is, you know, in every model we have some positive points and we have some negative points. So the negative points we are calling them as drawbacks, okay? So these drawbacks may be overcome by the next model. So that's why please keep in mind, so the model is not a complete thing, okay? But the model, what is going on right now, so that we have to believe and which satisfy most of the information regarding the atom. Okay, see here, right? It is what drawbacks of Bohr's atom model. The first point, it is valid only for one electron atoms. Example, hydrogen, helium plus, lithium, sodium, etc. But you have to see this one also, right? Hydrogen, okay? Next, helium plus, lithium plus 2, Na plus 1. So for this, like this, this is what one electron atoms. So this Bohr's model is valid only for one electron atoms, example like this, etc. Next point, orbits were taken as circular, but according to Sommerfeld, these are elliptical. See here, orbits here taken as circular, but according to Sommerfeld's model, according to Sommerfeld idea regarding the atomic structure, so these orbits are elliptical. Next point, intensity of spectral lines could not be explained. Next, it could explain the fine structure in spectral line. Right? See here, ma. Intensity of spectral lines could not be explained. So it could not explain the fine structure in spectral line. Next point, it does not explain the Zeeman effect and Stark effect. It does not explain the doubles in the spectrum of some of the atoms like sodium. So this, with this wavelength range, 5890 angstrom unit and 5896 angstrom unit, right? So with this wavelength, you know, it does not explain the doubles in the spectrum of some of the atoms like sodium. Okay, right. See here, what I am saying is, once again, I am going through the drawbacks. You please keep in mind, out of these, some of the drawbacks are very important because, you know, which leads to the spectroscopy. Here, these two points, one is the intensity of spectral lines could not be explained, and it could not explain the fine structure in spectral line. Okay. And this is what it does not explain the Zeeman. But these two points leads to that formation of discussion about the spectroscopy, because spectral lines here now. So here fine structure in the spectral line. What is spectroscopy and what is the use of spectroscopy? We are getting in physics little bit and in chemistry as well. Okay. See here, it does not explain the Zeeman effect and Stark effect also. Okay. Right. Once you look at all the drawbacks, because drawbacks also important for us to understand the atomic structure. See here, it is valid only for one electron atoms. Example, hydrogen, helium plus, lithium plus 2, sodium plus 1, etc. Next point, orbits were taken as circular, but according to Sommerfeld, these are elliptical. Next point, intensity of spectral lines could not be explained. Next point, it could not explain the fine structure in spectral line. Okay, right. So these two points belongs to like which required for us regarding the spectroscopy. Spectroscopy helps us to study the composition of one argon molecule or one molecule or one atom. Right, you know, drug for cancer, right, and drug for HIV. So when we are going to find drug, means in my view, it is medicine. So when we are going to find medicine for incurable diseases, that is like HIV, right, and swine flu, right, and you know, for like this, when we are going to find out the medicine in research laboratory, a chemical research laboratory. Right, by taking one particular atom or some group of one particular molecule, right? So we are going to allow some radiation. This radiation will pass through that particular matter and will give that energy diagram. It will give one spectrum, right? So by studying that spectrum, we can identify the nature of molecules and the composition behavior, etc. Right? In this area, spectroscopy helps a lot, right? That's why I'm saying these two points helps us regarding the spectroscopy. But anyhow, here we are talking about the drawbacks. So one is intensity of spectral lines could not be explained. Another one is it could not explain the fine structure in spectral line. Next point is it does not explain the Zeeman effect and Stark effect. It does not explain the Zeeman effect and Stark effect. Afterwards, next last point regarding the drawbacks is it does not explain the doubles in the spectrum. Doubles in the spectrum of some of the atoms like sodium. So 5890 angstrom unit and then 5896 angstrom unit. Okay. So regarding these wavelengths, you can say that it does not explain the doubles in the spectrum of some of the atoms like sodium. I think you understood what is meant by double, right? So which is giving two different wavelengths with 6 angstrom unit difference, but it is not explaining the cause for difference. Okay, right. Next, see here, radius of orbit. Now, till now we discussed about three points from Bohr model, and then we discussed the drawbacks of Bohr's model. Now we are going to discuss radius of orbit. See here, it is the expression, right? It is the expression. And you know, this you can write it as, I already told you many times in our previous class also, I told you, for an object or a body or a particle to revolve in a circular path, it requires the fundamental force. The basic force is centripetal force. The expression for centripetal force is mv square by r. Okay, right. You know, the centripetal force comes because of that attraction between the electron and the nucleus, right? In the last point I told you, in the last class regarding the Bohr model, I told you that is what the centripetal force for circular orbits is provided by the Coulomb attraction between the electron and the nucleus. This is what Coulomb attraction between the electron and nucleus, right? Observe carefully, this is what centripetal force and this is what Coulomb attraction between the electron and nucleus, right? And from these two things, right, from these two things, you can, you know, something that is what here it is R and it is M, it is V, right, like that. It is like constant, K value 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. And so based on this information, whatever we discussed, okay, you can write the expression for radius of the orbit. Radius of the orbit, that is Rn is equal to n square h square epsilon naught, n square h square epsilon naught divided by pi m e square z, pi m e square z. Okay, that is what I can say. Rn radius of the nth orbit, Rn is equal to n square h square epsilon naught divided by pi m e square z. Okay, just by replacing some of the quantities, some of the constant quantities, for example pi is 22/7. Okay, like that, you know, by replacing some of the quantities with a number, you can write the same expression as Rn is equal to 0.53 into n square by z angstrom unit, n square by z angstrom unit. Okay, right. Next, from this you can write this one, Rn is directly proportional to n square by z. Okay, right. Next, speed of electron. Okay, from the above relations, speed of electron in nth orbit can be calculated as, from the above relation, this is one relation and this is one relation, like that. From the above relations, speed of electron in the nth orbit can be calculated as, you know, Vn is equal to, because the speed of electron in the nth orbit, 2 pi kz e square divided by nh, okay. Right, that is equal to z e square by 2 epsilon naught n into h. Okay, and that you can also write it as c by 137 into z by n, and finally you can write it as 2.2 × 10^6. 2.2 × 10^6 × Z/N meter per second. These all are same, just we are writing one thing in terms of other, one thing in terms of other, one thing in terms of other, like that. Suppose if any constants are there, means that constant you can do mathematical division, right? There you will get some other constant that you can write, right? So these four different formulas, four different forms of that is what the speed of electron in nth orbit utilized in different situations, okay? For example, if they have given these three values, you can use this one. If they have given these all values, you can use this one. Like that we will use. If they have given only Z and N means, you can use this, right? Like that we can use. Next, see here, there is one table, right? You can see this table here. That is what this table is giving us, a quantity and dependency on N and Z. So whether it is dependence or not, okay, it depends. How it depends? That is the matter, okay? See, you know, different quantities are here, angular speed, frequency, time period, angular momentum, corresponding current, magnetic moment, and magnetic field, okay? I'll repeat once again. Angular speed, frequency, time period, angular momentum, corresponding current, magnetic moment, magnetic field, okay? So these seven quantities, whether see how they depends on N and Z, that we are going to discuss. See here, angular speed depends on Z and N like this. So Z square by N cube, and here a frequency depends on like this, Z square by N cube, and this is what time period depends on like this, N cubed by Z square, and it is directly proportional to N, and it is directly proportional to Z square by N cubed, and it is directly proportional to N magnetic moment, and it is directly proportional to Z cubed by N power 5. So like that, these quantities will depends on small N and Z. Next, we are going to discuss about energy. See here, ma, this is the expression for potential energy, K into Ze into minus E divided by Rn. That is equal to, you can write it as KZe square, KZe square, right? KZe square divided by Rn, divided by Rn, okay? See here, so U is equal to K into this value, that is equal to minus KZe square by Rn. Next, kinetic energy K is equal to, kinetic energy K is equal to, see here, ma, KZe square by 2Rn, it is what, radius of the nth orbit, and that is equal to U by 2, see here, U by 2. Next, total energy, you know, it is the sum of potential energy and kinetic energy, so you have to add these two, right, this one and this one, and then you will get it as, see here, this is the form, you will get K minus KZe square by 2Rn, okay, that you can write in this form, and then you can write like this, right? So finally, you can also write minus 13.6 Z square by N square electron volt EV. This is the value. So as I told already here, how we are writing for V in different forms, here also we are writing different forms for total energy, right? Where capital R is equal, here we have used the capital R, no? So capital R is equal to this value, and that is 1.09 × 10⁻⁷ per meter, which is also called as Rydberg constant, okay? Next, see the last point, ionization energy, last point from this class, ionization energy, and see here, ionization energy and potential energy, ma? See, this is the energy, ionization energy, E infinity minus En, and we have to write like this. Finally, we will get it as plus 13.6 Z square by N square electron volt. Next, for hydrogen atom in the ground state, what is the ionization energy? Means this is the ionization energy. If n is equal to 1, because for hydrogen atom in the ground state, n is equal to 1 means it will become like 13.6 electron volt, right? At the same time, what is the ionization potential, right? So it will be an ionization energy divided by E. So it will get it as, you will get it as 13.6 volt, okay, right? So in this class, we discussed Bohr model, And regarding the Bohr model, in the last class we discussed two points, and remaining points we discussed in this class. And then we discussed the drawbacks of Bohr's atom model. Afterwards, we came to discuss radius of orbit, and then speed of electron. And there is a table, we discussed there the quantity dependency on n and z. Then afterwards, our discussion energy and potential energy, kinetic energy, total energy. Afterwards, expression for ionization potential energy. And then what is the ionization potential energy for hydrogen atom in the ground state? Then what is the ionization potential? Okay, right. Thank you. We will continue in the next class.